Okay, now we saw last week, this morning we're going to do the book of Judges in 40-some minutes. 21 chapters, the book of Judges. This is just how it goes. We're doing the story, which is kind of a big picture fly-through of the Bible. So, we saw last week in the book of Joshua that Israel came to control Canaan, but they didn't fully possess it. So they basically broke in the back, they're in control, but they don't fully possess it. Various people groups continued to inhabit the more remote areas. And God told Joshua that he would drive those people out. He said, told him that he would do that, but as Joshua told the people in Joshua chapter 23, in the meantime, the people had to be diligent in keeping God's law so as not to mix with the remaining people and get pulled into the worship of their gods. If that happened, if they got pulled into the worship of their gods, if they mixed with those people, then God would not drive those nations out, and they would become a trap that would lead to Israel's exile from the land. Now, assuming Joshua was about 30 years old at the time of the Exodus in 1446, which are a couple of pieces of evidence that make that a reasonable speculation. His death at the age of 110 would have been in 1366 BC. Now, throughout his life, the people of Israel did well spiritually, and they continued on that course until the elders who outlived Joshua had died. So this is kind of a little, the chronology I'm trying to set here. Now, these elders would have included the older members of the group who had been under 20 at the beginning of the 40 years of the wilderness period. They had known all the work the Lord did for Israel, as it says in Joshua 24:31. So Joshua dies around 1366. You've got some period of time when the elders who are there survive Joshua, then they die, and the people are faithful throughout that period of time. Now, Judges in chapter 1, Judges opens in the time after Joshua's death. And it's during the days of these surviving elders when the people are pushing in faith to complete the conquest of the promised land. Okay, so they're in control, but they're not fully possessing it. There are some people groups that have to be driven out. Judges opens in that period after Joshua's death when they are faithfully pursuing that objective and that enterprise. And you have the tribes of Judah and Simeon. They went against the Canaanites, who remained in the southern hill country. They defeated 10,000 Canaanites and Perizzites at Bezek. And unfortunately, the location of Bezek is uncertain. But they defeated them there, and they also captured the king, Adonai Bezek, and they cut off his thumbs and big toes. Okay, they cut off the king's thumbs and his big toes, and as he himself acknowledged, God repaid him for the very same thing he had done to 70 other kings. So he had treated 70 other kings that way, and he is then captured, and that's what's done to him. And he recognizes that God in that was repaying him. Now the statement in verse 7 of Judges chapter 1, that they brought Adonai Bezek to Jerusalem. Now that statement seems to trigger a flashback to the days of Joshua that explains how they came to be, at least temporarily, in possession of Jerusalem. The capture of Jerusalem isn't stated explicitly in the book of Joshua, but it's at least hinted at. In Joshua chapter 10, where Joshua's executed, you have Joshua there, it mentions that he executed the king of Jerusalem. And so we see then in Judges chapter 1, verse 8, that the city was captured at least principally by the men of Judah. So he talks about taking Adonai Bezek to Jerusalem. That seems to trigger a flashback to the capture of Jerusalem that took place under Joshua. And then at some point after Adonai Bezek had been taken to Jerusalem, after that, the Jebusites gained control of the city. None of this is spelled out. Okay, that's not, you can't go look and see that, but that is apparently what happened, and it's not until King David, significantly later, it's not until King David that Jerusalem was permanently wrested from Jebusite control. So I'm trying to, if you're studying these things and looking, that's how I think the chronology works in the opening part of Judges. You have this flashback that takes you back, that's triggered, and then verse 16 of Judges chapter 1, it resumes the story of Judah and Simeon's successes. Remember, they're here, they're pushing on in faith in this period of the elders that outlived Joshua. They're still faithful, they're pushing on, they're capturing the southern hill country, the Canaanites. They defeat the Canaanites, the Perizzites, they capture Adonai Bezek. You have this flashback. And then in verse 16 of chapter 1, it seems to resume the story of their successes. And then here, though, we get the first indication in the post-Joshua age of a lack of faith. So now we see in chapter 1, verse 19, the statement that the men of Judah could not drive out the inhabitants of the plain because they had iron chariots. Now see, that's a way of saying that their trust in God waned in the face of this superior military technology. It's certainly not saying that God was unable to drive out people because they had iron chariots. Indeed, in Joshua chapter 17, verse 18, he declared that iron chariots would be no impediment to victory. He specifically declared that. And then as we're going to see in Judges chapter 4, Israel, by God's power, defeats Sisera, and he had 900 iron chariots. Okay, so when you see that idea, when he talks about it couldn't drive them out because they had iron chariots, that's an indication of waning faith and trust in God. They're discouraged in the face of that. So we have now, we're starting to see the weakening of faith in this post-Joshua age. In Judges chapter 1, verses 22 to 26, it recounts the house of Joseph capturing Bethel. Now, I take this that this was a retaking of the city after the initial fall under Joshua. The fall under Joshua, to me, is at least suggested pretty clearly in Joshua 8:17 and Joshua 12:16. And it's not unreasonable to think that possession of various cities and towns went back and forth over the time, this process of solidifying the conquest. As we move on, leave some people there, you can see how that would happen. Now, some people think that maybe this is another flashback, and it's just harder for me to see what would trigger that. Okay, so I think this is, it refers to a retaking. When we get to Judges 27, chapter 1, verses 27 to 36, that lists the failures of a number of tribes. Okay, now there are a number of tribes. It lists the failures of those tribes to complete the conquest by driving out the various groups as they had been commanded to do and as God had said, I will do that for you. Their failures to drive out a number of groups from the allotted territories. Now this left within Israel, their failure to do this left within Israel, Canaanites, Asherites, Amorites, and as said in chapter 3, indicated there, various other pagan groups. So now we're in pretty large scale failure of faith in living out what God had said. You have all of these groups listed there that are not driving out the people that they're supposed to be driving out. It is a breakdown in faith, and on that scale, we're now, this level of unfaithfulness now puts us a decade or more after Joshua's death. We're now in the time when the elders who outlived Joshua have died. Because, you know, they're faithful through Joshua. The elders who were living with him after they die, and then we have the falling away significantly. And that's what you're seeing at the end of that chapter. And so I'm thinking that we're at least a decade or more into that. So I think a good guesstimate of what time we're talking about now is about 1350 BC. Okay, I just like to think this way. I don't know if it does anything for you, but this is how I see. So 1350 BC is a good estimate. In chapter 2, verses 1 to 5, the angel of the Lord rebukes the people for their unfaithfulness in not driving out the remaining inhabitants of Canaan. God had told them, I will do it. You just trust me and you go about your business and do it. And if you don't, okay, if you wind up pulling on their gods and this kind of thing, then I'm not going to do it. Well, they wind up here, they're unfaithful to God, and the angel rebukes them for that, and he declares that now that the people will not be driven out. They're not going to be driven out. And instead, the people are going to be thorns in their sides, and they're going to be a spiritual snare for them. Well, the people hear this, and they weep and wail. And so the place is named Bochim, which means weepers. So this is the angel of the Lord presents this message and rebukes them and says, because of your unfaithfulness, Now the people are not going to be driven out. Chapter 2, 6 to 9, Joshua's death is again recounted in verse 10 of chapter 2. It specifically sets the following narrative in the time of the subsequent generation that did not know the work the Lord had done for Israel. And you see this idea, the difficulty in generational transmission of faith. Because people wind up seeing, oh, we didn't see all these things, and it becomes more and more difficult. So it is set in that time. Then in chapter 2, verse 11, through chapter 3, verse 6, we're given a summary preview of what takes place throughout the book of Judges, beginning at chapter 3, verse 7. Israel, from 3:7 through the end of chapter 16, this is the story of the judges. Okay, there are several chapters after 17 to 21 that are two appendices. But chapter 3, verse 7 through 16, that's the story of the judges. And we see there, and this is the summary preview in 2:11, 3:6 of what we're going to see in 3:7 through 16. And in that summary preview, Israel went after pagan gods of the people that lived among them. They pursued those gods, worshiped those gods, went after them. God then gave them into the hands of their enemies. The people then repented, and they cried out to God for help in their distress. And then He, in His great mercy, He then raised up leaders who are called judges to deliver the people from their enemies. This is the cycle that you see in the book of Judges. You have apostasy, oppression, repentance, and deliverance. And this repeats over and over and from Judges 3:7 through the end of 16. Okay, 3:7 through 16:31. A little bit about this. Now, Saul, who's the first king, Saul is anointed king, and you see that in 1 Samuel 10. That's around 1051 B.C., okay, so the time after the elders died, Joshua dies, 1366, around then. The elders are gone by, say, 1350. We have this apostasy. Saul is appointed king in 1051. So there's about 300 years, okay, from this apostasy and say, starting in 1350 to his being anointed king in 1051. And there's even less time, by the way, from Samuel, who preceded Saul. He's a judge, a prophet and a judge. So why I'm telling you that is that we know then that some of the times and the events in the book of Judges, they overlapped with each other. You see, they overlapped with each other because if you add up all the years in the book of Judges of the oppression and the years of deliverance and rest, so they're oppressed for so long, they're delivered, they have rest for so long, then they're oppressed again. If you add up all of those years, it comes to 409 years. Okay, so we can know then that some of these things are overlapping, and they're taking place, by the way, not in the entire nation, but in sections of the territory and involving particular tribes. That's important to understand. And you'll see it one good clear case of that. Now, judges, they're not merely, when we say judges, we think of judicial figures. Okay? People who are in black robes and that kind of thing. Judicial figures, they're not merely judicial figures who administered justice and handled legal disputes. Rather, for the most part, they are spirit-empowered military leaders. Now, Deborah, she summons Barak to fight. Okay, the woman doesn't go in and fight. She's a judge and she's a prophetess. But God has her call Barak, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But for the most part, they're spirit-empowered military leaders, whom God used to rescue the people from their enemies. So He calls up these judges, and they become the vehicle of God's rescue when the people cry out in repentance. And you see that cycle again over and over again. Now, the first judge who's mentioned, I'll just leave this map up here, and then when I get down, I'll get to this one. And that shows some of the, at least where the judges came from. They're not, the fighting's not always in those areas. But Othniel is in chapter 3, 7 to 11. Israel serves pagan gods, and you and I are sitting here going, how do they do this? Well, it goes on for a while, you know. You see how societies and currents change. And so Israel, they serve pagan gods. God gave them into the hand of the Mesopotamian king, Cushan-Rishathaim. And he gives them into the hand of that king. The people cried out, and God raises up Othniel, who's Caleb's younger brother, to free them. So here we have the first instance here in Judges chapter 3, 7 to 11. Judges 3, 12 to 30, Israel does evil. God gave them over to the Moabite king, Eglon. The people cried out. God raises up this Benjamite named Ehud to deliver them. Now, Ehud, he's a lefty. And I think that's significant because of where he conceals his sword. And I think he puts his sword, because he's left-handed, in a place that's not thought of as readily as if you're right-handed. But he builds an 18-inch sword. We might call it like a super dagger. And he puts it under his clothes to his right thigh. And he goes in to present Israel's offering, tribute, to King Eglon, who it seems is there at Jericho. And he goes in there and he says, by the way, gives a tribute, tells everybody you got to leave, and he tells the king, I got a secret for you. And the king says, okay, cool. Or orders everybody out. And then Ehud comes up here, pulls his dagger out and jams it, and it makes a point of how fat this guy is. And it pushes the dagger all the way in, it closes over the back part of the dagger. And then Ehud locks the door, and the people are waiting for the king to come out, and then they're going on, so they figure he's going to the bathroom. That gives Ehud time to leave. They finally realize something's wrong, go in there, and they find him, and then Ehud then rallies the Ephraimites to victory. So there you have that. That's the deliverance from their rebellion. They're brought and delivered over to the Moabite king Eglon, and then God raises up Ehud to deliver them. Shamgar's mentioned in chapter 3:31. He's mentioned simply in passing as having killed 600 Philistines. Then we get the story of Deborah and Barak in chapters 4 and 5. Deborah and Barak. Israel again does evil, and the Lord gives them into the hand of Jabin, king of Canaan, who reigned in Hatzor. Now presumably this Jabin was somebody operating under the dynastic name of the king Jabin who'd been killed under Joshua, in Joshua chapter 11, verses 1 to 15. You remember that he took Hatzor and he killed King Jabin. So presumably this is somebody operating under his dynastic name, and it seems that Israel's laxity in solidifying the conquest of Canaan, it led to a member of the royal house of Jabin then reasserting his rule from the area of Hatzor some decades later, and he becomes a real problem. Okay, because God uses him when the people rebel. He comes up, this particular Jabin, and he oppresses the people. The people cried out, and the Lord had the prophetess and judge. Deborah is a prophetess and judge. But in this case, God has the prophetess Deborah summon Barak. And through Deborah, he commands Barak to gather his men from Naphtali and Zebulun, and to gather them at Mount Tabor. And I think you can hardly see anything on here, but where is Mount Tabor? It's on here. I just can't see it. It's somewhere up around in here. Mount Tabor, I think it's right there. So he has, you gather your men there. The men from Zebulun and Naphtali, you gather the men, and you go to that Mount Tabor, and God tells me, he says, I'm going to draw out Sisera. Now, Sisera is King Jabin's general. He's the guy running the army. He says, you gather the men from those two tribes. You go to Mount Tabor. I'm going to draw out Sisera and deliver Sisera into your hand. That's what I'm going to do. Now, Sisera had 900 iron chariots, so this is a really intimidating deal. Here, you go gather there and fight this guy who's got this superior military technology. But don't worry, I'm going to give him into your hand. You see the guy's going, okay. So he says, he insists that Deborah accompany him. Now, he no doubt did that. It doesn't say this. But he no doubt did that because he wanted the benefit of God's prophetess on site. You see, they didn't have phones. He couldn't call her. And he's in the middle of stuff, and he wants her right there so he can say, hey, what's God want me to do now? Because he's intimidated. So this is kind of his security blanket. He wants her to be there for this access to God. And so Deborah says, okay, I'll go with you. I'll do that. But because of this, you're going to be deprived the glory of the victory over Sisera. He's going to beat Sisera's army, but you're not going to be the one who actually captures Sisera himself. You see, and that was a prize. In this world and culture, when you're fighting this kind of fighting, the guy who captures the head, the leader, there's glory in that. There's honor in that. She says, that's going to be denied you. Okay, instead, Sisera is going to be given into the hand of a woman. Okay, well, who do you want? Deborah, you got to come with me. All right, I'll come with you. But now what's going to happen is the glory of who takes out Sisera is going to go to a woman because you appeal to me, a woman, to come with you. Okay, so they do. This is how it happened. Barak insisted that, and that's what happened. So Sisera called out his chariots. Deborah gives the go. Barak and his men attacked, and the Lord routed Sisera's army. Okay, as God had said. Sisera, though, he realized when you're the head guy and your army's routed, you realize that's not good for you. Okay, because everybody wants your head, literally. And so he's fleeing. And he's hoping, he's trying to get away and escape. And he comes to a woman named Jael, J-A-E-L. He comes to her, and she tells him, well, you know, in essence, you can find refuge in my tent. That's okay. You know, just go ahead, lie down. I'll cover you up. It'll be okay. And so he goes in there, but when he falls asleep, she takes a tent peg and drives it through his head. You see, this is no weak sister here. This guy comes in there and boom, right through his head. So just as was said, the glory of who takes out Sisera, it's given to a woman. Now we get in chapter 6 through 8, we get the story of Gideon. Gideon, I think that's a well-known story, but we're flying over the whole thing, so we're doing the whole book, talking as fast as I can. Okay, chapter 6 through 8, we get the story of Gideon. The people of Israel, what'd they do? They did evil. You're just like, you're going, man, what is it with you people? But they did evil, and God gave them over to the Midianites. The people cried out, and after sending a prophet to them to warn them about their sin, God raised up Gideon. Now, Gideon is not too keen on this. He's not really sure that he's the guy for the job. And so, oh, great warrior, and he's going, who, me? You talking to me? I'm down here hiding from the Midianites. But he's not really sure about this, but he was given assurance that God was with him to accomplish Israel's deliverance. And the first time you see this is that the angel of God who called Gideon to the task, he had Gideon, look, you put on this rock the meat and the unleavened cakes that Gideon had brought out to him. He says, you put them on the rock, and then he touched them with his staff. And fire shoots up from the rock, consumes the meat and the cakes, and then he disappears. That's a pretty good indication that something's afoot. You see? That he says, okay, so this happens. And then later, Gideon's also given the signs, the very familiar signs of the skins that had wool on them, the fleece. He's given that sign where at his request, one night the wool was wet, but everything else from dew, everything else is dry. And then the next night, the wool's dry and everything else is wet. And so he's given these assurances that God would be with him. But Gideon, he had to pare down his force. So he's got a force of 32,000 people. He's going to go to war against the Midianites. 32,000 people, and God's response to that is that it's way too many. That's way too many. I mean, you're doing that, then I can see people thinking that was because of you. He has him pare down his troops to 300. He goes down, he pares them down to 300. He then let Gideon, by the way, as another blessing of assurance, he then let Gideon overhear the enemies interpreting a dream. He goes down to the enemy camp and he hears this dream and they're saying, uh-oh, this is Gideon. We're doomed. So he hears them interpreting that dream and God's telling him, okay, do you see? This is what I'm doing for you. And so that was more encouragement for him. And by God's power, Gideon defeats this vast Midianite and Amalekite army with only 300 men. Now, there's more to say about Gideon. There's more to say about all of these people, most of them, but I don't have the time to do that. Let me just say that after declining the people's request that he become a king, Gideon made a golden ephod. It's kind of like an apron thing. And he did that from the earrings that the people had captured from the Midianites. He says, go ahead and donate these gold earrings. He makes this golden ephod, and he puts it in the city of Ophrah. And then in chapter 8, verse 27, it says, and all Israel whored after it there. It's just really, and all Israel whored after it there, and it became a snare to Gideon and to his family. Chapter 9, we get the story of Abimelech. Now, Abimelech is Gideon's son by a concubine. And he winds up getting the people of Shechem. He has familial connections there. And he gets the people of Shechem to make him king over them. And then to be sure that none of his brothers, none of Gideon's other sons would contest his rule, he slaughters 70 of Gideon's sons. This is politics, baby. I got to get rid of my opponents. He slaughters 70 of his sons, and only Jotham, the youngest, escaped. Well, God's not pleased with any of this, and God instigates a conflict. You see, this is kind of a different story than the judges. He's not like raised up to deliver people. He's a selfish guy who's looking for power. He works politics to get here, kills these people. And then God initiates or he instigates conflict between Abimelech and the people of Shechem. And the end result of that, there's fighting between the two sides. And Abimelech travels to Thebes. And he goes there. It's about 9 miles north of Shechem. He goes there, and that's when the woman drops the millstone on his head from the tower. So that takes care of him. So he's taken out that way. Chapter 10, verses 1 to 5, you have a couple of judges. People mentioned as having judged Israel. It's Tola and Jair. And then in chapter 10, verse 6 through chapter 12, verse 7, so just a little over two chapters, we have Jephthah, the story of Jephthah. Now, the people again, what do? They forsake the Lord. They again turn against God. They turn from him and they worship a host of pagan gods. And the Lord gives them into the hands of the Ammonites in the east. Okay, the area east, mainly in the east. There was some involvement west of the Jordan, but certainly in Gilead, mainly in the east, he gives them into the hands of the Ammonites. And in the west, he gives them into the hands of the Philistines. So we've got Ammonites and the Philistines. Now, Jephthah was used to deliver the people from the Ammonites. And then we'll see Samson, he at least begins the deliverance of the people from the Philistines. And that deliverance won't be completed until Samuel, and that's a bit later. So Samson and Samuel are used as God's agents of deliverance against the Philistine oppression. So the people, they repent. They're under this oppression of the Ammonites. They repent, and in chapter 10, verse 16, it says, the Lord became impatient over the misery of Israel. I just like that phrase, the way the ESV. He became impatient over the misery of Israel. They're just getting the hammer so bad, and they're crying out, we're sorry, we're crazy, what's wrong with us, forgive us. And he became impatient of their misery, and then the leaders of Gilead, they begged Jephthah. Jephthah was a mighty warrior. He was known that this is a bad dude. Okay, so he was known, and they begged him to lead them against the Ammonites. Now Jephthah, he was from Gilead. But he had been driven from there by his brothers because he was the son of a prostitute. So this is his turf, but he was driven out of his turf by his brothers who said, who are you? Get out of here. You're just the son of a prostitute. You don't have any share with the family. You're an outlier. Get out. So he had been driven out of the place. Now the fact that these elders had earlier supported his being driven away, it wasn't lost on him that they were now coming to him for help. You see, this is quite a twist here, Where were you if I'm so important to you now? Where were you when I was being sent away and driven out? And you're over there going, that's okay with me. Yeah, go ahead. Send him out. But he recognized what was going on there. And he tells him, look, he tells him he'd do it. Okay, I'll come and I'll fight. But I do it on the condition that if the God grants me the victory over the Ammonites, I'm going to be your leader. Okay. That's good. We'll do that. So Jephthah, he first tries negotiating with the Ammonites. And part of the deal, he tells them, listen, their gripe and one of their things, at least, he communicates when they're saying, you took the land from us. And so what he does in his negotiation, first he tells them, listen, that's old history. You know, that's ancient history. We've been here 300 years. Now, you don't have to take that as literal, by the way, because this is rhetoric and part of his trying to, telling them it's been 300 years. So maybe he's just liberally rounding up. Or maybe it's just flat-out exaggeration, because it's part of his tactic of saying, nah, come on, man, that's ancient history. You can't raise that after all these years. Nobody else raised it in the intervening years, so what are you, crazy? But they're not listening to him, okay, because that was just really an excuse. But they're not listening to him, so he tries that. And then God then gave Jephthah an overwhelming victory. And you may recall the vow that he made, this tragic vow that he makes, that if God gave him the victory, he would offer to the Lord as a burnt offering whatever first came out of his house. And this is the thing. Lord, if you'll do this for me, I will offer as a burnt offering to you whatever first comes out of my house. And his daughter, his only child, was the first one out to greet him. And so that's just a tragic story, and you're probably familiar with that. Now, after this, after he's given this great victory over the Ammonites, the Ephraimites, they were angry because they hadn't been invited to share in the fighting against the Ammonites. And you and I are going, what are you, crazy? No, but this was a matter of honor. You know, it's like you treated me like a punk. I'm here, and you didn't say, come join me in a valiant fight. Because, our people and our lands are, so everybody rally and come. He said, you didn't have us. And so the Ephraimites were particularly offended by that. And this deteriorated into a civil war between Ephraim and the men of Gilead. Now we next have three judges who were mentioned briefly in chapter 12, verse 8 to 15. Isban, Elon, and Abdon. And they're just mentioned briefly there. Then in 13 to 16, we get the story of Samson. Very well-known story. Regarding the Philistine oppression, remember we had the Ammonites oppressing, and we've got Jephthah coming there and delivering the people from there. Well, regarding the Philistine oppression, God miraculously gave Manoah and his barren wife a son named Samson, and he gave them instruction. He's to be raised as a Nazarite. No razor put on his head. His hair grows all the time. No haircuts. And he's not to eat anything unclean. He's not to drink any wine or strong drink. And Samson was endowed with miraculous strength. You know, people say, well, you can't believe somebody can carry the gates of a city. No, it's miraculous. I agree that nobody just grows up and God's not working, they can't do it. But do you tell me that God cannot empower a man to do that? No. He can speak a universe into existence, but he cannot empower a man to do that. I said, I don't believe that. He's working miraculously through Samson. Now, Samson here, he winds up there. He's miraculously empowered, given miraculous strength. And unlike the other judges, see, he used his personal strength instead of an army to take on the enemy. So he's a little bit different. He uses his personal strength instead of an army. Now, the Lord moves Samson to seek a Philistine wife as a way to engage the Philistines. This was God's working. We look at this and go, what are you doing with the Philistines? God was at work. And he used that to engage the Philistines. And when at the wedding, see, you remember he tells them a riddle. And they bribe the bride. She ultimately rats out his riddle. And there was a bet on this. You can't solve my riddle. If you can't, I win the bet. If you can, you win the bet. So they bribe the bride. She rats out his riddle. And then he's chapped about it. But to pay off the debt, he goes and kills 30 Philistines and gets their clothes and says, here you go, and then he storms out. Okay, he storms out, and when he does that, they wind up, his wife-to-be is given to his best man. Well, he's not crazy about that either. And then after that, he burns the Philistines' fields at harvest. And then the Philistines, they come charging at him, and he killed 1,000 of them. You want a rough dude. They're jumping all over and doing whatever, and he killed 1,000 of them. So this is Samson. Now, Samson eventually was captured. There's, great story. But he's eventually captured when he revealed to Delilah, a woman he loved, that the key to his strength was that his hair had never been cut. Now, this is after he's told her many other things, and it's obvious that she's trying to have him captured. Well, then he then tells her, well, my strength is in that my hair's never been cut. Now, I believe that he lost his strength because his willingness to allow his hair to be cut off by revealing that to Delilah after she'd repeatedly tried to capture him, that shows that he didn't really believe that his strength was given to him from God, that it really was. He didn't think that unfaithfulness to his Nazarite vow would render him powerless. You see, he thought that would be just like everything else. No, if you do this, if you do that, and then he's always victorious, victorious. You see, he had really stopped understanding and believing that the source of my power is God, and he is with me because I'm faithful. So when he tells her, knowing after all she's done, that's what I see in that, is that he had lost his faith there, and that he no longer believed that God was his strength. Well, he found out. He found out when they cut his hair and they captured him, they gouged his eyes out. Okay, but the last act, in his final act, Samson, having been blinded by the Philistines, he's brought out for entertainment. This is a great conquest for them. So they're humiliating this guy. The great Samson who killed all these people, we took him down. Right? So he's out here brought out entertaining the people, and he prayed to God for one last miraculous empowerment. And God said yes. And with that, he broke the weight-bearing pillars of the building they were using for the entertainment, and the whole building collapsed, and that killed himself and some 3,000 Philistines. So that's the story of Samson. Now, 17 to 21, we get this double appendix. Okay, you have these. So that's really the story of the judges. It's from 3:7 down through 16. And then 17 to 21, you get this double appendix. The two at the end of both of these probably took place early during the period of the judges. And in the first one, you've got this wealthy man from Ephraim named Micah. This wealthy fellow from Ephraim, he built a house for his idols, and he installs his son as a priest for his shrine. Well, none of this is good. Do you see in all of this, when you read through this, the story you get is like there is rebellion and unfaithfulness and sinning, and man, boy, are these people ungrateful. And so he does this. He winds up, builds this place. He's got the idol, a house. He's got his idols in it. He's got his son appointed. Then a young Levite from Bethlehem, he's journeying through, and he stays there. And he winds up staying there. And Micah offers him a job. You're a Levite. Hey, that's close enough. Come on. You're a Levite. You go ahead and you be a priest for me. And so he agrees and takes the job. And then we have a search party from the tribe of Dan. They're scouting out some additional territory. They want to go out and see if there's some vulnerable places they can capture that they can inhabit. And so as they're passing through some of the scout party, they wind up, they scout out the territory, and they stayed at Micah's house, and they see the setup. So this dude's got, he's got all these idols, and he's got this Levite priest. So the scout party obviously comes back, and they let people know. They find Laish, and they say, yeah. So then you later have some 600 Danites. They're on their way to conquer Laish. That's the site that the scout party has spotted. Said, this is a good spot. We can take it. They're on their way through, and they stop off at Micah's house, and they take his idols. And they talk the Levite into coming with them. What do you want to hang out for this dude for? I mean, we're a lot bigger crowd. You can minister to more people. Ah, that's great. Okay, so he goes with them. And then Micah sees what's happened. He pursues them. He catches them. But ultimately, he caught them, but there was nothing he could do. They tell him, listen, basically, you better turn around before we stomp you. And so there was nothing he could do because they had a superior force to him. Now the second appendix, this is truly horrible. We have, that's first bell, right? Working hard. All right. We have the Levite, a Levite who lives in the territory of Ephraim. This Levite travels to Bethlehem to retrieve his concubine who had fled back home. And on his way back to Ephraim, he has her. He's on his way back to Ephraim, and he stays with an old man in the town of Gibeah in the territory of Benjamin. So he's passing through. This man offers him hospitality, takes him in. Well, the men of the city, after some drinking, surprise, surprise, grog, but after some drinking, they surround the house and they begin beating on the door, demanding to have sex with the man. Now, this is Sodom. You see, this is Sodom right in Israel. And so this is what they do. They're beating on the door, demanding you bring this dude out that we can have sex with. And the master tries to buy him off by offering his daughter and the man's concubine, which, as horrible as it was, that was perceived to be less horrible than the raping of a male guest. That was considered, not only is it homosexual, you're winding up, you know, I've taken this man under my roof. This is like a nightmare. So none of this is something that is good. But they thought, listen, this would at least be the lesser of the evils. Here, take my daughter and take his concubine, and they will have none of it. So then the Levite basically tosses his concubine to them. Grabs her, tells her to go out there, hoping that they'd settle for that despite what they said, despite their saying, no, we're not going to do that. And he sends her out there. And then the men abused that poor woman all night. And they left her dead on the doorstep. And then the Levite, he takes her body home, her corpse, cuts it into 12 pieces, and sends those pieces throughout the territory of Israel. He sends those pieces out there as a call to action. He says, look, this is an outrage, what has been done in Gibeah. And so this ultimately results in a civil war. People come down there, they say, hand over to perpetrators, they say, drop dead. Civil war ensues. And so this was a devastating civil war. It resulted in great loss of life, but Benjamin was finally defeated and was almost completely wiped out. Almost wiped out. Now, after their victory, the people of Israel, they're sorrowful. Because what they're realizing is that the prospect that the tribe of Benjamin was now bound to go extinct. It was bound to terminate. Because they'd killed the women and they'd all taken a vow that they wouldn't give any of their daughters to the Benjamites. And so there was no way for the tribe to continue. So they're in kind of a pickle. They don't want to have this, you know, this lamp of Israel, this one tribe of Israel go out. And so they felt bad about that, but they were in something of a bind. So they first go and they attack Jabesh-Gilead. Why did they do that? Because when they rallied people around to come and meet this horrible thing that had been done in Gibeah, Jabesh-Gilead didn't send anybody. So they attacked Jabesh-Gilead. They took 400 women, gave them to the tribe of Benjamin, but that wasn't enough. That wasn't going to continue the line, and there are people that needed more. So what they said then, they said, look, they authorized the men of the tribe of Benjamin to steal the women of Shiloh who came out to dance during a feast. So here they're going to be partying. See, and that distanced them because they'd taken a vow, we won't give them to them. They said, but you go take them, and we're not giving them to you. That was their thinking. You see, so they went and took them, and then they convinced the fathers and the brothers of the women to agree to that process after the fact. You see, so they were upset about that. Now, let me say two things. I heard that bell. I can say these quickly. I want to show you here this idea. What you see working here is moral relativism. This is at the root of everything you're seeing in here. It says, summary here, 21:25, in those days there was no king in Israel. Everyone did what was right in his own eyes. There is no standard I conform to. I do what, if it feels good, do it. Do your own thing. Whatever you want, you do it. And that's what you see. That's what you see in a relativistic culture. It deteriorates. It just completely deteriorates. Now, despite all the flaws, almost finished. Despite all the flaws of these men, I don't want you to miss the fact that God used them and that they were people of great faith. And we'll finish with this. Hebrews 11:32, that should be 34. It doesn't go backwards. It says, "And what more shall I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight." Understand that for all their flaws, all of their sinfulness, and all of the things that you can see about them, there was great faith in these people, and that is why God used them, because they trusted Him. Thanks for sticking overtime.